Great. So just to continue to introduce Mohamad, at this event, these instruments from the Islamic cosmological toolbox, reorienting to traditional wisdom in turbulent times. So I was initially introduced to Mohamad, as Shemessa said, through her. And it was a kind of pioneering time in some ways, because there wasn't a lot of grassroots stuff around Islamic ecology in terms of people getting together and trying to work within that framework. And we were doing stuff in the UK where this particular group, which was by a different name, was beginning to get quite a lot of momentum. And Mohamad was doing something similar in the States. And so we'd frequently have Skype calls and share ideas and challenges and get into all sorts of philosophical conversations as well. So it was often very mind expanding, and I really appreciated that, as Shemessa said, that groundedness, but that also that ability to be willing to reflect and open into new territories, and that creativity that comes with that. So that was really refreshing. I'm gonna just get up Mohamad's sort of formal bio. Okay, so Mohamad, he grew up playing in the sand and surf on both sides of the Arabian Peninsula, and then on the edges of eastern forests and city streets in the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. His intellectual and professional interests lie where the lines blur between East and West, cities and nature, art and science, and so on. Mohamad holds a Master's of Environmental Management with a focus on urban ecology and environmental design from the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies, and undergraduate degrees in religion and biology from the George Washington University. He completed doctoral coursework at the School of Architecture and Planning at MIT with research into emerging urban landscapes in the modern Middle East. Mohamad has followed his passion for working in nature and with people in parks and gardens across the US, with the Peace Corps in Central Africa and the United Nations in Syria. He consults on environmental and community development projects in both the US and the Arab Middle East. Mohamad was a co-founder of the DC Green Muslims Network and is a senior fellow of the Environmental Leadership Program and the Center for Whole Communities. So I'll hand over now to Mohamad.
Thank you for those kind introductions, Shumaisa and Muzammil. Shumaisa, when we met, it was 2005, late summer, and I was saying that Katrina was heading for New Orleans that weekend. The hurricane that devastated the city of New Orleans in the southern U.S. So I remember that really clearly. And Muzammil, thank you for taking me back also to those conversations that we had. I'm going to start formally, just kind of grounding with some traditional kind of Muslim opening and prayers, and I'll also do my best to translate. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. I start by asking or seeking refuge from Allah, in the name of Allah, the Compassionate, the Merciful. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. I testify there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah, no reality except Allah's ultimate reality, no light except Allah's light, wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the messenger of Allah. I'm also going to read from a surah in the Quran, and I'll translate. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. والتين والزيتون وطور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين. لقد خلقنا الإنسان في أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات فلهم أجر غير ممنون فما يكذبك بعد بالدين أليس الله بأحكم الحاكمين صدق الله العظيم. By the fig and the olive, and by the Mount Sinai, and by this city secure, we have certainly created humans, al-insan, in the best of stature. Then we return them to the lowest of the low. Except for those who believe and do righteous deeds, for they will have a reward unfailing. So what causes you to deny the way of the deen? Is not Allah the wisest, the most judge of the most just of judges? So, as I was saying, it's just real pleasure being here. I'm really grateful for this opportunity. I'm really inspired. I spent a little bit of time on the website. The five-strand activism I hadn't read before. So I really appreciate all the effort that went into that and the care and the thoughtfulness. I want to say a word or two just about where I am, who I am, and the kind of story that brought me here. And then I'm going to share a framework. Mostly they're questions that I have. And they fall within this, you know, this area that we're calling cosmology. I can't take credit for the title. It was like Muzamila and I were thinking about it. The word cosmology, just to break it down, it's just the story of the universe. It's the kind of origin story that from Greek means order, but also the universe is the opposite of chaos. And so it's just the Islamic story found in the Quran, and then the tradition about how the world started and humankind's place in it. I think I'd be remiss if I just didn't say something again about who I am and where I'm standing. And I recognize that we're kind of straddling the Atlantic, but I am in New York City. Increasingly, it feels really important also to name that this is indigenous land. And so I don't know how many of you would be familiar with the indigenous tribes and First Peoples of what's called Turtle Island, North America. And so the land of New York City is Lenape Hokan. It's a tribe, they're called the Lenape, across New Jersey, New York, and parts of Delaware. And so I just want to start also by paying my respects to the elders of the Lenape here in Lenape Hokan in New York, in the areas that I mentioned, but also across their diaspora. Parts of that tribe go all the way now, have been displaced to reservations in Wisconsin, around the Great Lakes, and even Ontario, Canada. And so to recognize, and this would connect to the talk and this idea of cosmologies, that they are the past, present, and future stewards, the caretakers of this land. And again, both past, present, and future. I identify as an American Muslim. If any of you have any trouble with my accent or any words, please don't hesitate to ask. Hopefully Shemesa has gotten you a little used to American English and you can jump in, Shemesa or Muzamil. And if there are any words that you just want me to define, I'm also happy to. I am of Syrian descent. I was born to two Syrian parents in Saudi Arabia, and Muzamil mentioned that in my bio. On the east coast there of Saudi Arabia, playing in that warm, shallow body of water called the Persian Gulf. And then we moved, and this is still in middle childhood. And I think that area of a person's life leaves an indelible mark, especially in terms of connection to nature and that imprint. And so I had where that the desert meets the sea landscape in my heart and mind. And then those eastern forests that Muzammil mentioned. But my mother always took us back. We were really privileged to be able to visit Damascus, where she grew up. And so it left a mark for me in terms of an urban landscape. And so the first time as an adolescent, and then also as an undergraduate in Washington, D.C., that I smelled the kind of exhaust, car exhaust on the city streets. I was also taken back to Damascus from Washington, D.C. And that still happens to me, even in New York City, where all of a sudden I found myself in a different place walking the streets here. And I want to name that because there's a moment I had as an undergraduate in Washington, D.C. on the campus of a very urban university, the George Washington University, that still shapes my outlook in terms of my environmental activism, but also social activism. And there were two courses I was taking as an undergraduate. One of them was a course on religion and the environment. It was called Man and Nature, and it was taught by a really prominent American Muslim, or I don't know if he identifies as an American Muslim, but his name was Sayyid Hussein Nasser, and some of you may have heard of Dr. Nasser. And then I was also taking a class because I was a major in religion and biology in field botany. And my professor, Elizabeth Wells, to teach us the names of plants and the taxonomy of plants. She didn't take us out of the city, but I'm really happy to say that she started with the plants right outside of our window. And so we learned the names of various plants on campus and then in urban parks and gardens across Washington, D.C., and then the edges of the city, and then finally out into the countryside, so to speak. And I immediately realized I was really kind of fond of conifers, these evergreens. And there was this tree on campus called cedars. There are three species of cedars, true cedars. There's the Lebanese cedar, which is kind of close to my heart because of where my family is from. And it grows on the cedars of Lebanon, or the mountains of Lebanon. There's a blue Atlas cedar, or an Atlas cedar, which grows in the mountains, the Atlas mountains of Morocco. And Maryam of Puris, if you've seen that. Depending on where in Morocco, you know, you spend time. And then the third cedar is the Deodar cedar. It's from the Himalaya. And so I remember walking down the middle of campus once and finding this blue Atlas cedar had been cut down. And the university was remodeling its plaza, a kind of square in front of the library. And it was around the same time in this course on religion and the environment with Dr. Nasser that I was learning. And I grew up schooled in Arabic and Islamic studies for most of my life. I was learning again that through both indigenous perspectives that these trees, what some people call more than human nature or non-human nature, the natural world, are living beings. Their relations, as indigenous people in North America would say, but also across the world. And as Muslims would say, they're fellow worshipers, right? Or they're in this constant state of tasbih, subhanallah, or dhikr. And so it just struck me that this, this tree that was downed or felled was another being. And it wasn't so much grief or sadness, though maybe there was some of that there. But there was this realization that, like, oh, this didn't have to happen, you know, that some other choice could have been made for this tree to stay standing. And a lot would have to be reworked in our values, in our value system, a kind of modern Western one. And this is the kind of analysis I was learning in class from Dr. Nasser, but also steeped in the Quran and other worldviews, that other choices are possible for humans, you know, not to transgress this way or not to take the more than human world so lightly. So that's the story. And since then, I think there's also more. There was work I was doing in urban public schools in Washington, D.C. But I think the gift that I was given by Dr. Nasser and these classes and Dr. Wells also was all the activism that I did, all the environmental training, professional that I did, all the social justice work was always steeped within this this framework, a worldview so to speak, a kind of holistic approach to understanding my place in the universe as a human being, where I was standing as a Muslim, and then also how I was allied to other holistic worldviews, indigenous or otherwise. And, you know, as I was starting to talk to Mzemmel about our conversation today, I've had this thought in my mind. I was like, oh, I would like to go back to Dr. Nasser's early writings. And I want to share, he was always telling us in class that that he was one of the lone voices in the 1960s, along with some other Americans like Rachel Carson, who wrote a book about the impact of chemicals on the natural world and on humans. And I wasn't quite sure what to do with that. It's not that I didn't believe him, but I wasn't really that exposed to that world. I hadn't really entered into the environmental movement here in the U.S. in a formal way. But then I want to say that some of the, you know, the books and the writings that I went back to just to prepare for the talk was one of his doctoral dissertation. It was written in 1958. So I think what I want to say, both as a kind of bow of gratitude to my teacher, Dr. Nasser, and to this tradition that I stand in, and I know some of you also identify with, of Islam, is that some of the heavy lifting, the philosophical, the ethical, and even the kind of mystical, has already been done. It's already there. And not just in this contemporary era, but, you know, Dr. Nasser's point is that this goes back to the 4th and 5th century of Islam. That said, is a kind of long introduction. I want to finally say that I don't come to this as a scholar. I really like what Mzemmel and Shemesa kind of already mentioned, is like, I come to this as a practitioner with some questions, and also as a practitioner who's not always working in Muslim circles. A lot of the work I do in environmental and social justice, I find myself doing outside of American Muslim circles. While I'm comfortable with that, I'm often and always kind of translating. And so I'm using, you know, this opportunity to think aloud with you, to ask some questions more explicitly and transparently than I usually would in these Islamic terms. And then to also push the conversation a little bit. I don't intend to provoke just to provoke, but I do have some questions that feel like, what if we took more seriously some of, you know, what we're learning from other traditions as Muslims? And so hopefully you get a sense for the stance, you know, that I'm holding and where I'm asking these questions from. So I want to pause and just share my screen here for a moment. And hopefully also it can kind of be a segue between a lot of introduction. Can you see the screen okay? Great, I'm getting a thumbs up from Mzemmel. And I can share this this image with you afterwards. I have 4 or 5 points. You know, maybe they're questions, maybe they're conjectures, maybe they're principles. Some of them I think are steeped in this Islamic cosmological worldview. Some of these icons are a little more playful and this notion of tools and a toolbox, and I'll explain them. Some of them also, you can see these Islamic kind of Persian miniatures in the background, and I'll refer to the stories that those come from. And some of these I feel more grounded in, like I can feel and speak confidently about. And some of them I'm less sure about, but I still want to share and think out loud with you, and hopefully you can take them into conversation. And one of them I haven't even put on the page. I mentioned it to Mzemmel last week. It's there, and I'll note it, but I think we'll run out of time, and we'll see if it comes up. It's a little bit more about kind of society and politics. But let me just name them, what's here, describe the imagery, and then I'll stop and go through them one at a time. And I probably won't have more than a couple of minutes to say something about each. And I'll check in with you, Shemay San Muzimman, about time. After I kind of go through these. This first one on the left, I'll do this clockwise, is the idea that human agency, our ability to act kind of on our own free will, is what the Quran calls an amana, which is a trust. Some of you may be familiar with it. It comes from the verse that says, إِنَّا عَرَضْنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَالْجِبَالِ فَبَيْنَا يَحْمِلْنَهَا وَأَشْفَقْنَا مِنْهَا. That we have offered this trust, this burden to the heavens and the earth and the mountains, but they refused it because it was too heavy. And instead, humankind, mankind picked it up. And indeed, they were ignorant of it. And this idea of an amana, I'm seeing into our kind of position in the world. And I'll say more about it and how it connects to the verses that I read from the chapter of the fig, Atin wa Zaytun. And this idea that humans are both the kind of most perfect of forms, but also the lowest of the low. And I'm using the icon of the hand. You know, all these icons are kind of graphics, and again, they're playful. But for me, it connects to Babur in the garden. This is the kind of Mughal emperor Babur in his garden. And you can see him pointing to this basin. And if you see in red down here, if you see my pointer, there's a man holding a red map. And so this is one of the earliest we have of notions of design, human agency. You know, in terms of Islamic art, of a designer, an architect, and this you could think of as landscape design. Some of you have mentioned permaculture, and again, I'll say more about this. Number two is this notion of appropriation, a cultural appropriation. You're hearing that in social justice circles and activism. What's right about that? What's wrong about that? But I want to ground that in the fact that Islamic cosmology specifically, but also more generally Islamic sciences, and have always been open to integrating, you know, what fits into the Islamic framework that connects to the Quran and the Sunnah and the traditions from as disparate sources as kind of Greek, Babylonian, Persian, Indian, all the way up to the Chinese. And so this miniature is of the Prophet's Mi'raj, the night journey and the ascent. You can see the Prophet here depicted, again, the flames. His face isn't shown, but he's on this buraq, this mystical creatures with the angels. And it's very Persianate. All of, you know, the miniatures are very Persianate in terms of the mythical creatures, but even the clouds at the bottom here, through the Persian kind of art, those are very Chinese. If you look at any Chinese art, you'll notice that these clouds, and I'm seeing that as symbolism, again, for inheriting wisdom. And there's a saying attributed to the Prophet that wisdom is the lost riding beast of the believer. So wisdom is like your horse, and you've lost it. Wherever you find it, you can claim it. And my contention here is like, okay, we can claim it, but how do we do that with wisdom? How can we appropriate wisely and not disrespectfully and honor the traditions that all these other wisdom has come from? And the playful icon here is, and I want to make sure that you all, I see you and you see me. Is anyone familiar with this icon from the Mac OS, the Mac operating system? When you use this icon in any kind of Macintosh or Apple graphics, are you familiar with what it does? I'm going to stop sharing my screen. Has anyone seen that eyedropper before? Do you have any graphic artists? Yeah, Muzamman has seen it. Do you know what it does? Feel free to answer, Muzamman, if you want.
I think I've seen it on Photoshop, and it fills a color in.
Yeah. It allows you to grab a color from anywhere on the screen and use that color, right? So without actually identifying, you know, the numbers connected to it. And I love that because my notion is like Islam has always had this for me. this notion of like, oh, that's a really beautiful color. We want to grab that and like add it to our color palette. And so I think of Islamic cosmology in that way. And again, I'm not saying anything new. Dr. Nasser has already kind of said this. And so let me then go around for the rest of them. And I guess I'm arguing is we need to do something similar again and again and do that wisely. And I would argue, especially with indigenous worldviews, and do that respectfully. Because there are ways in which that's being done without respect and with a lot of harm and erasure. These last two, I want to do more quickly, and then I'll check in with you all about timing. This idea of bifocals, you all know what bifocals are. Of course, you know, you can look both near and far. They're two kind of prescriptions, so to speak, within the same lens. It allows you to read, but also to look up and see. And this is an image, I think it's in the madrasa or the kind of laboratory, so to speak, of Taqiyyuddin. It's more Ottoman era. But these, first I want to name, these are all men wearing turbans. So very few of these images are not men. And we can talk a little bit about that, unless the angels, you know, clearly don't, even in their likeness, they're bending, I think, categories. But all of these scientists are using instruments, and maybe this is where the title comes from, the astrolabe, the sextant, the globe, to measure and to see. And I'm saying we need these instruments of bifocals, and this is an Islamic cosmological idea of let's get clear on what, when we're talking about this realm, this world, the world of the finite and the limited and the physical, and then let's get clear when we're talking about the infinite, the hereafter, or the realms beyond this world, and that humanity also in this highest of the high and lowest of the low, and in our connections to both the infinite and the very finite, and the fact that we're both physical and embodied creatures, but also have been cleaved from something more heavenly. And the Prophet's ascent is also a kind of a myth, right? In the best sense of that term, it's a story about that return. It has both of these ideas. And I think we have to be very clear on when we're talking about one or the other, especially when we're talking about ecology and change crises and what lasts and what doesn't. And so I'll say a little bit more about that and the politics of that and the ethics of it. There's a saying attributed to the Prophet, but it's not actually a hadith. Sometimes it's attributed to Imam Ali, and that may or may not be the case. And it says, live for this world as if you will live forever. Again, that's questionable as a hadith. And then the next part is, but live for the next world as if you will die tomorrow. And that very clearly is a hadith, or at least echoes some other hadiths that are more authoritative, because the Prophet also says, live in this world as a stranger or a wayfarer, you know, so that we're just passing through it. But I'll say a word or two about what the implications are, I think, for that both and. For activism, but also for, I see it in that five strand approach, the fifth strand of engaged surrender. And then finally, this notion of solidarity, which is really big, and maybe those of you involved in XR can say a little bit more about XR's approach, because it's really interesting. We have two XRs here in America, and they've split on this idea of solidarity. Of, you know, maybe what you all are calling it, wisdom in nature, is non-single issue activism, of, you know, the kind of intersectionality. But solidarity is, even if I'm not of a particular group, you know, how do I express solidarity with others? How do I stand in solidarity around peace and justice with other groups, even if I don't identify? For example, some people have asked about Black Lives Matter. I don't identify as Black. And yet, how do I stand in solidarity with Black people in the U.S. and across the globe, or non-Muslims, for example? And I want to ask questions inspired by this beautiful poem that some of you may know, called The Conference of the Birds, is a story by Attar about the journey, again, from the lowest of the low to the highest, to the most perfect form of these birds as an allegory. And my questions are inspired also by both and. When are we looking for that perfection in this life? And what are the pitfalls of that? And when are we looking for a kind of more perfect paradisal state, not in this life? And what does that mean? So I'm going to pause. Maybe that was more than I wanted to say by way of an overview. But I'm going to check in with Muzammil and Shumaysa and ask, how much more time do I have? And then I'll unpack some of these and hopefully ground them in some prompts that you can take into your conversation. Muzammil, what would you say?
Well, there's two options. If you want to unpack it a bit more now, that's great. We can open it up for one or two questions before the small group discussion as well. But if you've got something you feel will be really helpful to say in terms of detailing it out a bit more, then we've got time to do that.
Thank you. Yeah, let's do both if that's okay. I would love to hear one or two basic, if anyone has explanatory questions for me. And then I will just say a word or two away from the images and more just get into the kind of heart of the matter, so to speak, with the why do these questions matter? What am I getting at? But let me pause and see if any of the participants have any kind of basic questions. Are you following? And if you point me to something, would you like to hear a little bit more about? That can focus kind of a few more minutes of unpacking and explaining. Okay, bismillah. I'll dive in then. With regard to amana, the first thing, the question that I'm holding is, can humans actually improve on Allah's creation, right? And that's like a provocative question, and I ask it provocatively on purpose, just to kind of open up some space. And I think what I want to say is we don't have a choice as human beings. Like, if I take the Islamic cosmological understanding as I understand it, there's no sitting on the sidelines for human beings, right? I don't actually buy that there is untouched nature, that there's nature untouched by human impact, especially standing here on Turtle Island in the United States. I think when European settlers first came, colonizers, they saw this beautiful, Eden, and they saw it as theirs to colonize, right? Actually, that's not true. Indigenous people were shaping this land for a long time through fire, through hunting. And I think that's the case even in sanctuaries. So Mecca is supposed to be a sanctuary, and Islam is supposed to have inherited this notion of a hema, a sanctuary. But human impact from the moment we were created was clear. The angels, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam, said, أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءِ. Have you created on this world a creature that will spread mischief and shed blood? And so they saw through our creation immediately. And so that's why I think this amana is we don't have a choice. Just by our very existence and the nature of the world, either the world is deteriorating because of our existence and our impact in it, or we align with our fitrah, this kind of primordial nature that we have, and we become attuned with this worship that the rest of creation is in, and we continue to improve upon it. Or build upon it. The concept from the Quran is called amara, to build on the earth, to sustain it. And so that's my first point, and I will leave it at that, which is like humans don't have a choice. And if we detach from the natural world, we're already and will continue to be at a loss in it and held to account. So there's no sitting on the sidelines. Either we're active agents of improvement and righteousness, or we'll be held to account. And the balance, if you will, though I don't really like that word, the mizan, it's more like the measure of things, will be thrown off. Our amana will be shirked, so to speak. So that's number one. Number two is this notion of appropriation. And it connects to solidarity for me, so maybe I'll join them. I see in Islam's kind of history and cosmology, and Dr. Nasser points this out, a pluralism. And that pluralism that is like Islam doesn't have all the answers, right? Muslims don't have all the answers. And that we need to actively engage other faith traditions, but also other worldviews and other people who may not be of not just our faith, but maybe secular, right? Or actively secular, or seeing religion as problematic, and that's okay. But let me ground that in a couple of Quranic concepts. And the Quran says, وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا. We created you as peoples and tribes so that you may know one another. And so this notion of ta'aruf is like none of us see the whole, right? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most all-seeing, all-wise. And so this notion of wisdom that's ours to get from anywhere, right, is we need to learn from one another. I had a teacher who said there's a threefold framework, which is ta'aruf, learn from one another, ka'aluf, it's a kind of relationship and a kind of when our hearts become entangled in one another. So to really befriend each other, both within our community and outside of it, and then to kamul, to complete one another. And so it is too urgent, the kind of climate crises, these racial and economic crises, that we're in, they're too urgent for us to be in our own silos or to imagine that we have all the answers. And I think my point around this appropriate but wisely is that it's always been part of Islamic tradition to look for wisdom outside of our tradition, to ask whether it syncs up with Islamic worldview more generally. And that really only means anything about tawheed, really, la ilaha illallah Muhammadan Rasulullah, and then to adopt it and to run with it and to build on it. And I think that's enough about that piece. And I think the contention is that Islam has actually always been appropriative, but it's also always invited appropriation for people to take from Islam also. And I wonder how that sits for people. Number three is this notion of bifocals. Dr. Nasser would always say that the environmental crisis is a spiritual crisis. And that makes sense to us. I think what the point is like it's a manifestation of a kind of a lack of understanding of our position in the world, in the cosmos, or that amana, that we are trying to feed a spiritual hunger with material things. That's probably not a surprise to many of you, but that we're confusing the finite and the infinite. So Khalil Gibran, who's a Lebanese Arab American poet, he was heavily influenced by kind of Sufism and many other kind of traditions, but he's a Christian Lebanese poet. He said, you bring to your friend your needs. Don't bring them your emptiness. Like our friends cannot fill our emptiness, right? And I really appreciate that. It's like if there is a spiritual hunger we have, or that Dr. Nasser would say modern man, right, in his words would say is kind of at a loss for that. And my point I think that I'm trying to make with these bifocals is, I do think Islam asks us to build on in this world, to imagine a kind of sustaining, as if it could be forever, but to also know that we could die tomorrow, and so to live for that. And they see that in that engaged surrender. And I think the point that I want to make and move on is that not to confuse spiritual work or spiritual perfection with utopia. I do not think we will get to justice, a kind of perfect sense of justice in our lifetimes, or even in this world. That doesn't mean we don't work for it, but liberation from the kind of dunya, so to speak, is not the same thing as kind of creating here on earth a paradise, right? And so I want to be careful with that. And this is really not my idea, and I'm happy to explain where it comes from. But I think the last thing I want to say about it is there's sometimes we approach this notion of coupling spiritual work and activism, that if we get really perfect spiritually, the world will mirror our perfect spirituality. And I don't think that's going to happen. And there are two ways to ground that. One of them is kullama alayha fan. Everything on this world will perish. This is from Surah Ar-Rahman. وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبُّكَ ذُّ الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. And it's only the face of your Lord that sustains, you know, in its glory. And we need a both and there, a bifocal approach. And I think the Talmud says that really well, which is yours is not to complete the work. Like, don't put this work down. But yours is not also to finish it. Don't think you can finish it either. And so I'll stop with that. That's the piece around both and bifocals. And that also sets up the solidarity piece. So I'll say a word or two about it and end. The Quran is very clear that our journey back to our origin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is very individual and specific. It says, لَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. Like, when we are returned, right, on the day of judgment, however you want to imagine it, right? And there's also a saying that's attributed to the Prophet is that when a person dies, that's their day of judgment, right? But that verse from the Quran, لَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وَزِرَ أُخْرَى, is no one is asked to carry the burden of anybody else. Like, we're going to be asked about what we did, right? So no mother can carry the burden of their child, right? No sibling, that of their sibling. We're going to be held to account for, you know, our own actions. And you see that in issues of karma and what have you. I still think, and this takes a little bit of that both and thinking, it's inspired by that conference of the birds. Raise your hand if you've on video and you've heard of this poem, Atbar's Conference of the Birds. Yeah, so the Conference of the Birds is this allegory. The birds are supposed to be spiritual seekers. They go over seven peaks and valleys. There's a myriad of birds, each one of them with their own kind of, you know, qualities, their genius, so to speak, but also their foibles, right, their challenges. Their guide is the hoopoe, the hoodhood, and it shows up in the stories in the Quran and Sulaiman. And mantaq al-tayr comes from that, this notion that Sulaiman was taught the discourse of the birds. And when they finally get to the simurgh, which is what the hoodhood is kind of promising them, that they'll get to this mythical phoenix, the king of kings, so to speak. The pun in Persian is the simurgh is this phoenix bird, but it's also 30 birds. And so when they finally get to the palace and they look around, they realize they've gotten to the simurgh, but they are actually 30 birds, a simurgh, that have gotten there. So in each other, they also finally witness attest to the divine in the journey itself, but also in each other. And this is that notion of the solidarity of the spirit, is like, we're not working for a utopia in this world. All right. And each of us is responsible for our own, if you use the Buddhist word, it's liberation. And I'm inspired here by some friends who are Buddhist teachers. If you use the more Christian, it's this notion of salvation. And maybe Islamic terms, it's that return to our fitrah. It's what that story of a teen with Zaytun says. I want to make sure I get it. Is لقد خلقنا الإنسان الإنسان في أحسن تقويم أحسن إحسان. This notion of seeing the infinite even in this finite world. And so my last point here, and I'll wrap up, is there is a solidarity both in activism and in justice work. There is no perfection in that work. It will always be messy and unfinished. And we need to make sure we're also engaged in our own spiritual perfection, so to speak, and we can unpack that word or wholeness. And we can support one another in that work. And supporting one another in our activism can also be supporting one another in our worship as well. And I think that's not foreign to Islam, that Islam, our actions are also is part of our worship. And so that's it for that 4-4 framework. I will show it once again, and maybe this is what I will end with. So you can see it, and maybe the visuals you can take into your conversation. And I'm about to wrap up here. There's a fifth piece, and I won't say very much about it, but I mentioned it to Muzammil, and you can ask about it. Maybe it could come up in your conversations. And for me is, what are the politics of this worldview, of this cosmology? What are the political commitments, especially in this day and age, that it asks of us? All right, we come from a tradition that has had kings and queens and caliphs and sultans and emirs. And I think very often this notion of a hierarchy and a cosmos and this image that you see in the center is the kind of mandala slash cosmograph, an image of the universe that comes from, I think, 4th century Islamic thinkers and writers, Gnostics, called Ikhwan al-Safa. It's very ordered, it's very stable, it's very hierarchical. But I'm really wary of a politics that's hierarchical, that takes stability and harmony and balance as like its most important piece. And I can talk a little bit more about that if you all want. And I am asking out loud is, what, and I have democratic commitments that are much more horizontal and consensus-based. And Muzammil and Shamesa spoke to those with the consensus process-based approach. And I'll stop with that. I don't have much more on that piece other than the questions. Wallahu a'lam, and Allah knows best.
Okay. Thank you, Mohamad, for expanding our minds, for pushing the boundaries and asking questions for us to delve into. So just in terms of time, we'll soon go into breakout groups to consider the concepts and ideas that Mohamad put out. And also the sort of the question. And around, I'm particularly interested. And feel free to share how you like in the small groups, but also at a sort of personal level, how this sort of resonates and our own experiences are often really, really useful to bring in terms of trying to sort of add some flesh and I guess relevance in our own lives and our own groups and networks around some of these themes. Where does it land in those sort of spaces, or where are those spaces at in relation to these themes? So we'll we'll delve into some of this in our small group. Then we'll come back and share in the large groups. I think two groups actually is probably going to be good enough, and myself and Shemessa will hold those. We'll, before we do go into the small groups, we'll have in a moment a 5-minute comfort break, in which time I'll organize the breakout groups. And also just to sort of give an idea of how we encourage people to share, that the first thing to maybe say is that we, you know, difference is to be welcomed. we want to give space for ideas that may be seemingly in conflict or in opposition. And there's something really valuable that I think is missed when we can give space to differing ideas, and not just about defending one, is that it's sort of space of, I find anyway, that it's one in which, firstly, we have to get comfortable with the unknown and the fact that there's no fixed one perspective, which is disorientating. But in that disorientation is an opportunity for a rejiggling and a reconfiguration. And if we can stay with that, and it may not come to any kind of, you know, conclusion in that conversation even, but that's a place of growth. That's a place of growth. And so that's what this is about. It's a place of where we can all grow through the chemistry that we bring by being together. So, okay, so we'll just have a 5-minute comfort break, and then you'll get to go into your small groups. And we'll fire into the small groups when we're all back. So just 5 minutes.